be here. Every sheriff.
Really?
Every other sheriff, just about, was personally talked to, face to face, or on the phone, by me and another guy. So they all had opportunity to be here. They all knew what this was about. Why they're not here is something you need to ask your sheriff about.
Yep.
Yeah. Our sheriff is here. Most of you seen or heard during Katrina the things that happened, the devastation, and all the things that went around it. People were hungry, people were thirsty, people were hot. In Camp Shelby, our efficient government had trucks and trucks down there, FEMA, sitting there loaded with ice and water. Sheriff of Forest County took it upon himself to defy the federal government, do what he was sworn to do, take care of his county, and went and commandeered two trucks full of water and ice and spread them about his county.
Good. Yep.
This man is Billy McGee. People need to realize things like this when they're getting ready to vote for their sheriff. You know, it's one thing to say, I believe he would do this. I believe he might do that. I believe that he might stand up and do this. But it's better to have somebody that you know will stand up and do this. So to introduce our guest, Billy McGee.
Thank you, Billy Don. I appreciate that. I've been asked to introduce the speaker this afternoon, whom I happen to know and respect, and I'm certainly privileged to do that at this time. When I think about the sheriff, I think of a quote from a man over 100 years ago who said, "He who joyfully marches to the music, hand and foot, without asking any questions, without determining whether it's right or wrong, has already earned my disdain, for he has been given a large brain by mistake, since for him a spinal cord would suffice." And that's what I think about when I think about our speaker. The heroes of my life and through history have been those that were willing to step outside the box, step outside the comfort zone. And as the sheriff, when I know where I'm going, and I know how to get there, and I know that my guys are behind me, it's easy to lead. It's not a problem at all. It's those times when you don't know the outcome, you're not sure about how to get there, and about how this public will perceive what you've decided to do. So I consider this not only a great American and a friend, but a great American and a friend to law enforcement and to the United States of America. And tonight, I asked the Sheriff Mack if he'd come forward and give his address. I'd also like to apologize. I have a prior commitment that I have to be at 2:00. I've heard him speak before. I hate that I'm not going to hear him this time. It's always something different and new. But please welcome my friend, Sheriff Mack.
Wait to hear. Let me explain one other thing. There were 7 sheriffs that did the lawsuit in this country. And there was, if you'll see this victory for state sovereignty, it names the states. One of them was Mississippi. This started in 1994. He was the one, and I want him to tell you why he joined that lawsuit. There was only 7 out of 3,100 sheriffs. He was one of the 7. Magnificent 7. Why don't you say what your motivation was to join that lawsuit?
My motivation was that I felt like there was an intrusion on the gun owners of America. I thought it was unfair that they were requiring the sheriff to be responsible for doing background checks, which was mandated by the federal government. I thought that it was improper that they would not tell us what the repercussions were going to be when I issued one of those background checks and it happened to be something in there that was flawed or a misrepresentation, who I had no knowledge, no way to prove that it was a fraud, and what would be the repercussions to me civilly and criminally. So that's why I chose to sue the company.
Makes sense. Thank you, Sheriff. I'm going to start this out by what I have up here, and then we'll get into some other stuff. What?
Can we go back to your table?
No. Nah. It gets busy, maybe. I don't think people are going to be too enthralled with this to go anywhere. So, yeah, go ahead and hit the lights. And I'm going to try to, we don't really have a sound system, but I'm going to put this down on my computer and see if you can hear this pretty good.
Obviously, this is your constitutional right, okay? As far
far as we're concerned, you're not breaking any laws, okay? That's what we want to get across to you guys.
Myers objects, ordering airport employees to allow only ticketed passengers upstairs, accusing the activists of blocking the escalator. But once again, Deputy Lennox defends their First Amendment right.
That is a review for, I told you what. I have Jason Burns.
Let me see your identification.
He can show you my identification.
He doesn't have to show you his identification.
The activists continue their mission. The video later posted to YouTube and goes viral. Not the kind of attention Deputy Lennox is used to.
That's a little overwhelming. I'm still in my job. I did the right thing. I felt I did the right thing, you know, protecting people's First Amendment rights.
A deputy sheriff protecting people's constitutional rights. Where have you ever heard of such a thing? Crazy, isn't it? Then as I was scrolling through this on YouTube.
Wyoming sheriff is now saying that he believes.
Okay, Wyoming sheriff. Sheriff's across, Wyoming sheriff says agency will ignore any gun control laws it considers unconstitutional. Then it goes right into Sheriff Tim Mueller from Linn County, Oregon, right next to Douglas County, where we see Sheriff Hanlon. Sheriff Hanlon came out back then and said the same thing. So we're not going to support any more gun control laws from the federal government. The Utah Sheriff's Association, minus that one idiot in Salt Lake County that was talking earlier, that somebody mentioned earlier, yeah, you did. He's the only one out of the 29 sheriffs in Utah that didn't sign a letter to the federal government, to the White House, both president and vice president, saying that the state of Utah, these sheriffs, 28 sheriffs, would no longer tolerate the federal government attempting to make criminals out of law-abiding citizens. Wow.
Awesome.
Yes. You see, Deputy Lennox, 2 years ago, 2 years and 2 months ago, was named the CSPOA, Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers Association, Deputy Sheriff of the Year. And that's somewhere on YouTube as well, but we're not going to go into all the YouTube presentations. My point in bringing all of this up about the sheriffs, and I need to get out of this so I can get to my other part of this presentation. This is the organization that I started about 5 or 6 years ago, and this is the one that has started this movement to have sheriffs actually stand and protect people. And I have yet to see, as a matter of fact, I also wanted to take issue, was it you that said, who was it that said that we need to be like Rick Perry? Or that we need to have people like Rick Perry because he held up a gun, fired a shot off, or whatever. Texas doesn't even have constitutional carry. They don't even have open carry. I think they just barely passed open carry. Rick Perry never moved to get open carry or constitutional carry. We have now 5 states that have constitutional carry. Texas is not one of them. Mississippi is not one of them. And it's just astonishing to me, if you don't have constitutional carry, what kind of carry do you have? Unconstitutional carry. Do you know that gun control in America is against the law? Do you know that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Gun control in the United States of America is against the law. And so how many lawless legislators do we continue to support in this country? Especially in the federal government, where they have no business being involved in this issue at all. And I will tell Mr. Obama or anybody else in Washington, D.C., or any place else in the country or the world, in the United States of America, gun control is against the law, whether you like it or not. And we don't get to violate the law just because we have a shooting in Oregon or Sandy Hook or any place else. Statistical analysis of the effects of gun ownership does not make the Second Amendment go away, nor the intent of the Founding Fathers, nor the Declaration of Independence, where it says we the people are in charge of all this, and if we want to throw off such government, we can, but you cannot. President has no authority to nullify the Second Amendment through executive order or executive action. None.
Amen.
Has none. Okay? And if there are any regulatory authorities out there anywhere, the states would have them, but when the state constitution and the federal constitution forbid gun control, they're bound to, just as much as the president. So the whole thing of this propaganda scheme of, oh, we've got to use this, these shootings to promote more gun control is absolutely despicable. Just absolutely astonishing that he can get in front of the entire country and say, I don't care about my oath of office, I don't care about the Constitution, I don't care about the Second Amendment, and I don't care about you, and I want to ask him, Mr. President, one, do you know the understand the intent of the founders when they penned the Second Amendment? And secondly, please tell me any of your proposals that will take guns away from criminals. Mm-mm. Have you noticed that he's never once proposed anything that will take guns away from criminals? His whole speech yesterday was about, we should be like England, we should be Australia, and what did they do?
Confiscate guns.
Away from law-abiding citizens.
Yep.
Yeah. Criminals still have them in London and they still have them in Australia.
Sure do.
You know, and of course they don't tell all the statistics there either, but. The whole thing that we're after here, Deputy Lennick, that's what we're after. If we could get, now there's about 800,000 police officers, peace officers in the United States. We would love to have just 10%, give me 5% that are Deputy Lennicks. Give me, out of the 3,100 sheriffs, give me 500 or 600 that are like Billy McGee. And on my new book, Are You a David? Well, of course, I want to emphasize that question on the book, Are You a David? With a female sheriff from Texas. Of course, I want to say, hey, why would a female sheriff be there asking if you're a David? She's obviously not a David. And she obviously is a David. Just contradicted myself, didn't I? Now, I was going to put myself, I wrote this book. I've written several books. I didn't even bring all my books. I brought about half of them. But I was going to be on the front page, front cover of that book. I could put myself on it if I want to. It's my book. But I fired me. And I put Sheriff Pamela Elliott on there. One, she's better looking. Two, she's female. And three, she's a current sheriff. And four, she's a constitutional sheriff. You know what she just had the audacity to do? She arrested local mayor for public corruption.
Awesome.
Arrested her. Yeah. God bless Pamela Elliott. Yeah, what a great lady. Former Marine and former police officer in Arizona, in Gilbert, where I actually live right now. And every one of you need to read this book. What I want you to do is help me make sure that 10% of our law enforcement officers and sheriffs in this country read this book. Because there's no way a public official could read this book and look at their job the same. And of course, the book that started it all, I've got back on the table, is The County Sheriff, America's Last Hope, which a lot of you already have, but if you don't, please make sure you get that one. And then about 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, I did a book called The Magic. I need to get my mic. Do I need my mic back on?
No, you're good.
Yeah, I'd rather stay on there because I'm going to show some things there and I'll keep that. So, The Magic of Gun Control. And people have looked at that and say, you think gun control is magic? I said, yeah, I sure do. They said, why would you think that? Because if it ever did anything good, or if it provided any benefit to you or me or anybody else throughout history, it would have to be magic. And that's what our politicians want you to believe today. They want you to think that it'd be different here in America. It won't be like Hitler's gun control. It won't be like Pol Pot's gun control. It won't be like Stalin's gun control. It won't be like Mussolini's gun control. It won't be like Castro's gun control. Are you following this yet?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It'll be different in America. It'll be magic. It'll do what it's never done before. It will actually make us safer. And if any of you believe that, I got beachfront property for you in Omaha. Because it's a big lie, it's a propaganda scheme, and if there's anything these politicians are good at, it's propaganda schemes. That's all this is. And what is the propaganda scheme? The whole thing is, Let's move away from our Constitution. We're smarter than the founding fathers. We don't need it anymore. We're much more sophisticated now. I mean, look at all our weaponry and look at all our big, huge cities and skyscrapers. The Constitution just doesn't apply. As a matter of fact, a couple of years ago, Time magazine wrote an article on July 4th, actually it was on 2011, so about 4 years ago. July 4th, 2011, they wrote an article honoring our Day of Independence with an article showing the Constitution on the very front page of the cover in shreds. Constitution's in shreds. Now that's very revealing. And the article was, does the Constitution still matter? And that's the title. And then he, Richard Stengel, the managing editor of Time magazine, gives a comedy article that is so ridiculously stupid that I can't even imagine why anybody would buy a Time magazine unless it's to laugh at them anymore, because that one was funny. He actually said, we can't know what the founding fathers intended. They're dead. I know. So we can't read Common Sense by Thomas Paine. We can't read the works of Thomas Jefferson. We can't read the Federalist Papers. We can't read all the notes that James Madison kept. We can't read the letters back and forth from Abigail Adams and John Adams. We can't read George Washington's inaugural address or his farewell address. We can't read those anymore. They're dead. We don't know what they intended. We don't know what they meant. And then he went right in from there, and there's no way these stupid founding fathers, and I'm saying that, but that's really what he means. You can read the article for yourself. Again, July 4th, 2011. Does it still matter? Talking about our Constitution. And then he literally says this, and I'm not making this up. This is, quote, he goes in, and I can't remember all of them, but I remember the punchline especially. You see, the founding fathers couldn't have envisioned skyscrapers, jet airplanes, computers, cell phones, mini skirts, okay, and Lady Gaga. I promise. That's in the article. Those stupid founding fathers. No wonder the Constitution doesn't apply today, because they could never have envisioned Lady Gaga. If we could go back and ask Thomas Jefferson or any of the other founders, show them a video of Lady Gaga, the only thing I think they would have said is, boy, you guys are really nuts if you think that's entertainment now, you know? But that's about as far as they would go. In fact, if they would have heard her sing at some places, they'd say, hey, you know what? For being so weird looking, she does have a pretty good voice. That's as far as they would take it. They don't care otherwise, but they do care about the perpetuity of our Constitution. In fact, George Washington said, the Constitution is the guide which I never will abandon. And that's what we want to train all of our peace officers to do and say. We're never going to abandon it. We want thousands and thousands and thousands of deputy sheriffs and peace officers and patrol officers and chiefs of police who I really wished had stayed here to hear this. We want you to follow the Constitution. We want you to keep your oath of office. We want you to be just like this guy when there's a problem. And you know what? If they had another deputy sheriff that day, those two people probably would be in jail and there would be a lawsuit being settled right now about it. Most of the time the deputies would go, well, did he ask you for your identification? Oh yeah, but I told him I didn't need to give it to him. I told him my name. Why would you do that? Give me your identification, and then they would take it and go and make copies of it and bring it back to him. And Deputy Lennick, what did he say? Yeah. I can't give you that. They don't need to give you that.
Yep.
Wow, how did he know that? And then he comes back later and says, you haven't broken any law. We want you to know that. You're exercising your constitutional rights. Oh my gosh, how did he know that? And so obviously, if he can, why can't we get everybody else to look at this? In fact, that you want to solve the problem with police brutality in this country? This is what you need. This is all you need. Learn your oath of office. enforce the Constitution in every situation that you're writing somebody a traffic ticket? Uphold and defend the Constitution, first and foremost. Oh, you think writing too many tickets is against the Eighth Amendment? Wow, how did he know that? What's the Eighth Amendment? No excessive bail, no excessive fines, nor cruel and unusual punishment. And ticket writing's all three. Have you seen the destruction that goes to people who maybe get three tickets in 1 year? How their insurance rate goes up? And why is it that law enforcement allows, or legislatures allow, insurance companies, private companies, to gain access to the public records of traffic citations? It's none of their business. If they want to talk to the customer about it, they can, but they don't get to go down to the courthouse and get immediate access to everybody who gets a traffic citation. And not only that, most traffic citations are unconstitutional. They're excessive in the quantity and the excessive in the amount of the fine. They are excessive and they are a violation of the Eighth Amendment. Yes, granted, cops don't issue the amount of the fines, but we sure issue thousands and thousands and thousands of those ridiculous tickets that have nothing to do with safety or providing safety or any threat to safety. And the reason I say that is because I used to do it, and I've done some serious repenting. And I would tell you this, if anybody I ever wrote a ticket to came back and said, you got me for $30 there in 1986, I don't know how much it was, I would give them back their money. Because I feel that strongly about it. It was wrong and immoral. And for us to continue to gouge the American people through this system of taxation through citation is wrong and immoral. Do you see the cities that were really hurting financially? Flint, Michigan, Lansing, Michigan, San Francisco. What did they tell their cops to do to help them out?
Write
more tickets. And they even gave quotas to some of the cops, which they said they would never do. Quotas are absolutely a conflict of interest. Absolutely. Which makes them unconstitutional. And a lot of agencies don't have quotas, but what do? It's the same thing. We had this when I was a rookie cop. Your supervisors are always telling you, you better be out there writing more tickets. They didn't say how many, but you better be. You come back with one or two, you're definitely going to hear about it on your evaluation. You come back with 35, 40, and you're the top cop of the month. Okay, that's how it works. It's wrong. How are we going to recognize that it's wrong? Well, let's go back. Let me go back to my presentation, and I'm going to show you some things that are here are absolutely amazing. Martin Luther King, there are two types of laws, just and unjust. Did we not see that right here? Where the sheriffs, they even put it on Fox News, where the sheriffs were determining what was unconstitutional. Didn't I take an oath? How am I going to keep my oath if I don't make a determination as to what is unconstitutional? Some sheriffs and chiefs say this, we will do anything to the people here, we will make any type of enforcement until the Supreme Court tells us it's unconstitutional. Just how many cases do you think go before the Supreme Court every year? And in other words, you're going to continue to violate the Constitution, laws of equality, until the Supreme Court says something. Well, we're going to get right into an example of that real quick. I would be the first to advocate obeying just laws. Me too. Totally. One has not only a legal but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. Conversely, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. So I know you're still saying, who determines that? The person who took the oath. Is there anybody's oath that says, I promise to uphold and defend, I solemnly swear and affirm that I will uphold and defend the Constitution as long as the local legislatures allow me to. Or as long as the local judges or the Supreme Court allow me to. Or as long as my sergeant, chief, and patrol lieutenant allow me to. Is there any exception like that in the oath of office? In fact, if you don't keep the oath, you are committing perjury. You cannot abdicate your oath to someone else. That's like taking the stand as a witness. A cop takes a stand as a witness, as I've done hundreds of times in my career. And I get up there and they say, will you tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God? Yeah, as long as my sergeant tells me so. That's not how it goes. You cannot abdicate your word or a sacred oath to someone else. And the sheriff, being in charge of his agency, must determine what is constitutional. Let's get right into that, what we're talking about. There's the oath. That's the oath that's required by every public official in this country. You must swear an oath of allegiance to the state constitution and to the federal constitution, which is based on the enforcement of what Abraham Lincoln said when he said, our forefathers brought forth on this continent a new nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. And that's what our Constitution is there to enforce. Our God-given rights are to be enforced, and they are supreme to any man-made law. And can there be any state statute that supersedes the Constitution? Did you hear what the idiot from the airport authority said? You're violating our airport guidelines. Our airport guidelines. He thinks that supersedes the First Amendment to peaceably assemble and freedom of speech. And he even tried to get him for, did you see the girl all by herself blocking the escalator? Oh yes, the old crime of blocking the escalator. Sounds like something out of Maxwell Smart, you know? Mm-hmm. Ah yes, violating the escalator, yeah. All right, and this is where the Founding Fathers, they are making sure in this Article 6, last paragraph, U.S. Constitution, that all of us in government, whether we're teachers, cops, sheriffs, legislators, mayors, governors, we all do one thing. In three separate branches of government, we all do one thing. What's that? Uphold, defend, protect, and preserve the U.S. Constitution. What's the Supreme Court supposed to do? Uphold, defend, protect, and enforce the U.S. Constitution. What do they do? They're a political hack for whoever appointed them. And that's the reason we got these wonderful decisions we've seen recently. Whoa. Wow. What is the legislature supposed to do? Uphold, defend, protect, and preserve the U.S. Constitution. What is a cop supposed to do? What is a sheriff supposed to do? Uphold, defend, protect, and preserve the U.S. Constitution. That's it. No, it isn't simple. I don't even want In God We Trust on our police vehicles. I want guards of the Constitution, guards of liberty, guards of the Republic. That's what I want on. That's what we swore to do. Then we all can trust God again, if that is. If we can't trust our cops, it ain't gonna help me too much to trust in God. I do, and we need a miracle, and I've seen some miracles, and this thing with Deputy Lennox was a miracle. Absolutely. And we need some more miracles. And thank God that we have some people out there that are trying to make this happen. What I want each of you to know and understand is there's very few peaceful solutions left. And what you're seeing here, did you see Deputy Lennox? Peacefully diffuse a very volatile situation. That's what we're after. Mm-hmm. We want that happening nationwide. Our training, that's exactly what we do. Deputy Lennox is on our DVD set of that conference in St. Charles, Missouri, where we gave him that award. Another award went to the only dark-complected sheriff in all of Wisconsin. You see him on Fox News about twice a week. Amen. David A. Clark Jr.,
yep.
Very good friend of mine. Sheriff Clark is an example of what we want as sheriffs in this country. Sheriff Brad Rogers in Elkhart County, Indiana, who actually stood for an Amish farmer who the FDA was attacking over and over and over. for not pasteurizing his milk. You know, you let those Amish go on stuff like that, and you'll have crime all over the country. I mean, come on. Thank goodness we have the FDA protecting us all from these Amish farmers who actually believe that they can put cows out on their land, let them eat the grass, bring those cows in, milk them, and then let people drink that milk. Can you imagine that criminal? So the FDA was taking this Amish farmer to a grand jury. Now, remember, he's in Elkhart County, Indiana, to Detroit. How's the farmer going to get there? By buggy. And so it was an impossibility for him to. So he complained to the sheriff finally. And by the way, just so you know, he passed every inspection the FDA did on his property of all his farm products. Everything was A+, clean. They even did a forensic test on the milk, see if it had any problem. No problem. That's what happens when you let Mother Nature do its job. Everything's fine, you know. And so he calls the sheriff. Guess what the sheriff does? Contacts the FDA and say, hey, did you have any probable cause to come after this guy? No. Did you have any, what was your due process? It was just a spot inspection. Did you have any duly signed warrants? No. He said, if you ever come back in my county without those three items, I'll arrest you for trespassing.
Awesome.
And so, of course, what does the FDA do? They got their little feelings hurt. Mm-hmm. Oh, you can't have that. So, they threatened to arrest Sheriff Rogers. Sheriff Rogers calls me and he says, hey, I got to tell you this. It's pretty funny. And I said, man, that is funny. You're having fun, aren't you? And he goes, yeah, kind of. And he says, but would you help me devise a response for him? And by the way, if any of you want that response, email me and I'll email it back to you. Okay? And I still have it, even though this was 3 years ago. So he emails him this response, and he signs it, not me, but it was for him. And he emails him the response, and 3 days later, David Hostetler, the Amish farmer, gets a notice, certified letter from the FDA, telling him everything had been dropped. No more spot inspections. In fact, the FDA hasn't gone back to Elkhart County, as far as Rogers knows, for the last 3 years, ever since then. They've left, they're gone. Every time, and we have it, I have incident after incident where sheriffs, Sheriff Clark, Sheriff Rogers, Sheriff Palmer, Sheriff Finch, every time a sheriff stands for the Constitution and against federal incursions, they win every single time. When I was sheriff, I not only sued the federal government, not only sued the Clinton administration, then had six other sheriffs from across the country join the lawsuit, as I said, Sheriff McGee being the one from Mississippi. We also had a bridge washout. Now, in Arizona, it's really easy to have a flood because it's flat and dry. So the Gila River rolls through our county, and we had about an inch and a quarter of rain. Here, you don't even get wet with that, do you?
Nope.
Yeah, see, here in Arizona, inch and a half, that's flood, okay? And so you get an inch and a half in 1 day in Arizona, you're going to have flood problem, especially where I live, in the valley. And so a bridge washed out, and we're going to fix the bridge, okay? And it has nothing to do with me. I'm not the maintenance crew that fixes bridges. The sheriff doesn't do that. Okay, so the Board of Supervisors are trying to get it done, but the Army Corps of Engineers won't let them touch the bridge, won't let them do any fixing, nothing. They said, why? They said, well, we have to do an environmental impact study. A year later, they still haven't got it done. So finally, they vote unanimously to just fix the bridge. The Army Corps of Engineers threatens to arrest all three of the county commissioners and threaten to arrest all the maintenance workers and charge a $50,000 fine to the county for every day that they're in violation. Can you imagine that kind of fun? Now I get involved, right? Somebody's trying to arrest people from the federal government in my county without even checking with me? So I call them in. I said, hey, you guys, you can read in the papers how crazy I am. I'm already suing the federal government. If you think I'm kidding on this, well, go ahead. Think I'm kidding. But if you try to do anything in my county like that, like arresting anybody, I will arrest you. And if the county attorney lets you out, I'll arrest you again a day or two later. I said, you're not arresting anybody in my county. Okay? They left, we fixed the bridge, nobody paid a dime in fine, nobody went to jail, everybody's happy. Okay? Those guys are still getting their retirement. Coincidentally, I was at a funeral for a Marine 3 years ago in Tucson, and a guy comes up to me and he goes, "You don't remember me, do you?" I said, "No, I don't know who you are." He handed me his card. He goes, "I was one of those Army Corps of Engineers that you laid the law down on." And I said, "Pretty cool." He says, "I totally supported what you did, man." He said, "That was so cool." He says, "I just couldn't tell you at the time." And he says, "Man, you're great. That was fantastic." I said, "Well, glad you said hello." Now, let's get into this. This is what we need. We have got to make this movement bigger. Folks, I don't know of any other peaceful solution, an effective, peaceful solution. Show me. Tell me it. I'm going to join it right now. Yes, there are other good groups there. I want the tea parties to keep doing what they're doing. But that whole thing is still part of this peaceful solution. But do you want something fast? You want your you want to stop IRS abuses?
Yep.
Have a constitutional sheriff. Let them know that they're not welcome in his county anymore. Or if they do come to his county, they're to check with him first. You want to know another creative thing that sheriffs can do? Tell the federal government no more random audits. Why not? Because they're unconstitutional. They have to have probable cause and due process. They don't. The courts say they can. The courts don't manage my office. I know that's kind of strange. Mm-hmm. But if you want to vote for Elena Kagan to be your sheriff, then you go right ahead. If you want Sotomayor to be your sheriff, vote for her. But until I'm out of office, this is how it's going to be. And he does his job. And he puts them on notice. No more random audits. How's he going to stop it? He goes to the banks and he has a breakfast. And he wants all the managers at the breakfast. They all come. He tells them, no more random audits. In fact, if you get any order from the IRS to turn over bank accounts of any of my citizens, you tell them to come to me. They go, "Well, we're not going to do that." No, he says, "I thought you might say that, especially you guys from Chase." Mm-hmm. Okay? You Chase and Bank America guys think that you're only working for the IRS. As long as you're in my county, this is how it's going to be. So, I'm going to put in the newspaper every month which banks are banks for the people and which banks are for the IRS. And then we'll let people choose which banks they want to do business with. And please tell your boss in New York I said so. Okay? And tell him I said hello. Okay? If you get 500 sheriffs doing that in the country, there's no stopping them. And we take back freedom one county at a time, sheriff by sheriff, state by state, and we work through the counties and the states and the sheriffs to restore liberty to America. And I'm asking each of you to join us in that holy cause. And I have sign-up forms with our organization. Do I want you? Do I need you? Should you join CSPOA, Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers Association? Do you have to be a cop to join? Absolutely not. The people of this country has made this organization go. That's why we're still successful. That's why this is happening. We had 95 sheriffs at our first convention. You know what half of them said? Tea Party groups and our citizens called us and said they wanted us to go. And so we're here. A couple of the Tea Party groups paid for their way. We paid for anybody who couldn't pay for their own. We paid for most of the sheriffs to come. Flight and hotel. Yeah. Very successful event. We've got to keep doing this. We're going to certify trainers all across the country. You. We want you to be able to do the same type of training that I'm showing you up here. You need to know the you need to know the Mack Printz case. You need to know and understand this case and what it did. When Sheriff McGee was saying that this is why I didn't do it, this is why I didn't do it. One is he didn't point out, I'm going to show you here in a minute, that they actually threatened to arrest us. The federal government threatened to arrest the sheriffs who failed to comply. Serious. Failed to comply with their, you know, we all should have just told them to shove it. Yeah. We don't work for you. I no more work for them than an employee of Safeway does working for Walmart. Now, it's ridiculous that they think that they can bully people around like that. And there was only 7 sheriffs that said no. 7.
That's a shame.
Amazing. Yeah. Let's keep moving here. All right. State nullification. That's exactly what this is. It is a principle and it's associated with state sovereignty in the 10th Amendment.
First of all, you have to ask yourself a legal and lawful question here. Who enforces the 10th Amendment? Department of Justice? Congress? The President?
The governor should.
It's everybody in your state. Mm-hmm. But governor, absolutely. None of us would even have to if the governor would do it. Governor and legislature. They don't do it, you got your county commissioners and your sheriff. And if the county commissioners won't do it, you still have your sheriff. But the power retained by the states is what this whole thing is based on. The federal government, let me tell you this right now, the federal government is not in charge of enforcing the 10th Amendment. We have to. So what does it say there in yellow, in gold? Look at it. States have the authority to judge the constitutionality of the federal government's laws and decrees. That's right from Thomas Jefferson and James Madison. You can believe them. You don't need to believe me. Go ahead and just believe them, okay? He also argued the states should refuse to enforce laws which they deemed unconstitutional. And Madison, wow. Look at that word down there in the third from the bottom. It's in gold. Interpose. Interpose is such an amazing principle that it's almost beyond description. Interpose is a doctrine, a biblical doctrine. There is a great interposer on our behalf. And I don't want to get too religious, but you all know who it is. And it's the same with us. If the innocent American citizen is here, and the IRS agent is here trying to get to them, the sheriff simply gives the basketball defense stance. And if the IRS agent or the other criminal from the federal government moves, I move too. Okay? Yes, I used to play basketball. Thank you very much. And wherever he goes, the sheriff goes. And this person is protected. And what does interpose mean? Put yourself in the way. And that's all the sheriff has to do. It's not violent. He didn't even have to arrest him, although that would be really fun. But he doesn't have to. Put yourself in the way. Do what you promised to protect, defend the Constitution from all enemies, both foreign and domestic. It's not the sheriff's fault that the federal agents have become domestic enemies. Not our fault at all. It's not who. It's what? What are they doing? And who am I supposed to protect? It's a simple matter of keeping our word. Okay. Now, these are the two sheriffs that made it to the Supreme Court on this particular case. It was myself and Jay Printz from Montana. I think Billy went to the hearing at the Supreme Court. I think that was the first time I ever met him. And look what the judge said in my district court case. Mack is thus forced to choose between keeping his oath or obeying the law, the act, the Brady Bill, subjecting himself to possible sanctions. Remember I told you the threat of arrest, right? That's what the judge was referring to. But isn't it amazing that when you have a quandary of which one you're going to keep, your oath or obey the law? It's not even a law, statute, okay? When an officer does not enforce unconstitutional laws, he's not violating the law. He's upholding the law. And isn't it amazing that they think just the opposite out there today? Oh, we have to enforce all the laws. Really? Show me where you enforce all the laws. Show me all the laws on the statutes of your state and show me that you enforce every single one of them. If you did that, the people would hate you and you'd be in office 2 days. Show me how many tickets you wrote for jaywalking today. No, it's ridiculous. First of all, that's simply not true, and it's stupid. This Cleo, you know what a Cleo is? I know you know what a Leo is. Chief Law Enforcement Officer. In the Brady Bill itself, it calls us sheriffs the Cleo. Yeah. So if you want to see where it ever claims that the sheriff is the chief officer of the county, just tell them the Brady Bill itself.
Hey.
Yeah. And here's the threat of arrest. There it is. I didn't make any of this up, folks.
What does GCA stand for?
The Gun Control Act. Gun Control Act of 1968. That's the federal Gun Control Act that happened because of the shootings of the 60s, both Kennedys. And so somebody had to do something because all the Kennedys were going to be killed off if we didn't do something. So they come up with the GCA. Okay? Crazy. Yeah. Ronald Reagan talking about our tax system, you know, totally un-American, unconstitutional. Jennifer Long testified before Congress that the IRS routinely fabricates evidence against citizens who they know financially cannot defend themselves. So they either commit suicide or just pay whatever they can and try to go on with their lives. And the IRS knew it. And the IRS, guess what? Still does it. This is 1997 that she testified. And she worked for the IRS at the time. She did not quit. And she didn't get whistleblower protection. It is incontestable. This is in this United States Supreme Court case that I was just talking about. It is incontestable that the Constitution established a system of dual sovereignty. All the states surrendered. That's not true. Scalia made a mistake there. The states surrendered nothing. We didn't surrender. What did the states do as pursuant to the wording in the 10th Amendment? We delegated powers to the new federal government. And were they many? No. But just the opposite. Discrete and enumerated. In fact, Scalia now repents and shows what kind of powers. Residual state sovereignty was also implicit, of course, in the Constitution's conferral upon Congress of not all governmental powers. Well, if they don't have them all, then what kind do they have? Well, he says right there, only discrete enumerated ones. That's all the federal government gets. If you look inside your constitutions, how many powers were delegated by us in the Constitution to the federal government? Article 1, Section 8, about 20. What the Supreme Court gets, about 11. What the president gets, 6. The president has 6 powers. 6! So there's a total of about 35. In the entire Constitution. I'll give them a few extra. I'll give them 50. And they've stolen about 5,000. Mm-hmm. And so what do the states do? Nothing, because they keep giving us money.
Yep.
Hey, idiot governors in this country, idiot legislatures in this country, guess where they get the money? From us, from the states. Stop sending them the money, and then you won't have to grovel like a little beggar in the street to get 5% of it back. The states could be so wealthy if they just stopped sending their money to a wasteful, ridiculous federal government. Why do they do that? I still have yet to know why they do that. Stop it. Stop doing it. And then they won't hold you hostage with all these ridiculous grants. Okay, then, rendered express. Look at that word. Only discrete enumerated powers. Which implication was rendered express? It's rendered express by what? The assertion of the 10th Amendment. Who's going to assert the 10th Amendment?
The states.
We're the only ones left to do it, and we're assigned to do it. Then it quotes the 10th Amendment. That's why. You see the formula for freedom? Scalia and the Supreme Court, when a handful of sheriffs sue the Clinton administration. Oh, and by the way, I lived to tell about it.
Good to know.
Another miracle.
Uh-huh.
I know. Sue the Clintons. And wait, you know, man, wow. You know, I'm the only person in history to sue Bill Clinton on a non-sexual matter. So, here it is. Here again, he reinforces the solution. Look what he says, just down here. Well, let's read the whole thing. This is in the little booklet. Again, you get these free if you buy any book, or they're a dollar each. Buy extras. Show people this. I handed this to Greg Abbott when he was the AG of Texas. He already knew about the case. And I said, so why don't you use it in these cases you keep filing? But I said, you know what, Mr. Abbott, you shouldn't be filing any cases against the federal government. Tell them to stay out and tell them no. You know, the Declaration of Independence that is also in this little book, the Declaration of Independence says we have the right and the duty to throw off despotic government and establish new guards. Throw off such government. How are we supposed to do that? Oh, because we vote? That's not it's not talking about voting, friends. And if we can throw off such government, don't you think it would be appropriate at the first stage of that to simply tell the federal government, no, you're not doing that here anymore, stop it. Oh, but we'll pay you federal grants.
Nope.
We'll give you all this money. You can keep that too. Oh, and by the way, we're not sending you any more money, including federal income tax. Woohoo, there's the first shot, woohoo. And you don't have to fire a shot. That's the whole thing on this, folks. This revolution to take back liberty is peaceful if we have the courage to do it. I'm totally amazing that we could do this. We have it within our power. Oh, I admit, it's unusually. Yes, Deputy Lennox is an anomaly. I admit it. But he shouldn't be, and we can change that, and we can change it overnight, but we've got to get moving. Don't you wish we had more like that? Don't you wish we had more of these constitutional sheriffs that are sitting, that should be here today learning how to do it? This separation of the two spheres, the state and the federal sphere, is one of the Constitution's structural protections of liberty. My dear friends, it's in this decision. You see the power of this decision? A structural protection of liberty is called state sovereignty in the 10th Amendment. Just as the separation and independence of the coordinate branches of the government, of the federal government, serve to prevent the accumulation of excessive power in any one branch, a healthy balance of power between the states and the federal government will reduce the risk of tyranny and abuse from either front. So how do we stop abuse and tyranny? The states must get back the healthy balance of power that we need. You think there's a healthy balance of power today?
Nope.
What a joke. Yeah. I mean, we bow to the federal government, but really, do you know the only power the federal government has over us is the money.
The money.
That's the only power they have, and they know how to use it too, and they will continue to use it. And you hear the chief of police in Phoenix right now bragging about he got a $3.5 million grant from the benevolent federal government to get body cameras and to hire more cops for Phoenix. Oh, wonderful.
Kind of strings, huh?
Yeah, no strings attached either. It's just free money. It's just free money. They say it's free money. It's free money.
Nothing.
It's a free lunch. Yeah. Isn't that the same thing Hitler did? You know, just kind of.
Mm-hmm.
No, you can get it. All of this boils down to, hence, a double security arises to the rights of the people. The different governments will control each other. Folks, right in this little decision, it says that. All of these quotes that I've just showed you are right in this little booklet. The Mack Printz case, the Mack Printz McGee, Romero, Frank, Anders decision. Those were the seven sheriffs. None of them should have been excluded. I wish all seven names were on there. My name got taken off. It's just, if you look at it in the books, it's Printz. He was the second to file, I was first. I don't know why my name got off. That probably some clerk in one of the judges' office said, we don't want to keep two names, so we'll take Printz. That sounds better. I don't know what happened. I don't care what happened. But there were seven sheriffs that did this, and they should all be on there as far as I'm concerned. It's an absolutely miraculous case. The most powerful 10th Amendment decision in the history of our country. Nobody talks about it hardly, huh?
They want it to go away.
Especially, oh, exactly. And that was planned. Yeah, absolutely a plan. Okay. Where'd she go? Here she is. Now, this to me, when they said, remember, all laws have to be enforced. Have to enforce all the laws. I don't get to say what's constitutional. So, let's see what history teaches us about that.
Let me have those front seats.
So what does he do? Gets on a cell phone and calls the cops, right?
No.
No cell phone then?
Nope, no cell phone, so he gets off. Anybody know the date? December 1st. Did you hear the Christmas music in the background? Mm-hmm. December 1st, 1955. Montgomery, Alabama. An American citizen is arrested for not giving her seat to another citizen. What did the Supreme Court say about that at the time? Separate but equal. Really, another gem from the Supreme Court. You're all equal, but we're still going to keep you separate. Anybody get the propaganda behind that? Anybody get the lie behind that? You're separate, but you're still equal. Oh yeah, of course, I get it. As long as we stay in the back of the bus, then we're equal. We're fine. No. You have to know something. I really want to do this. I want to call somebody up. Come here. Yes, you, ma'am. I was already bugging you out at lunch. I might as well bug you again. Okay? Come on up. You don't need to bring your purse. Okay? Just come on up here. I want you to sit right here. Let's see. Right over here so I can. Okay? Guess who you are. Go ahead and guess who you are. Yeah, you're Rosa Parks. Sorry. Yes. Okay. So she's Rosa Parks. So I'm going to show you what Deputy Lennick would have done. I'm going to show you what Brad Rogers would have done. I'm going to show you what Sheriff McGee would have done. And I'm going to show you what I hope I would have done that day. Okay? This is how it should have played out. The call comes into the sheriff's office. And the good sheriff hears the call. And he goes, I better take this myself. One of the deputies goes, man, is that lady in trouble? The sheriff's going himself, you know? So he takes a deputy with him and he says, come with me. They get on the bus, and there's Rosa Parks still sitting up there at the front where she's not supposed to. And they walk up to her, and the sheriff is right here, deputy's back here, and he walks up to her. You know, he's not real mad, but he's kind of perplexed why she won't just obey the law and obey the bus driver and get to the back of the bus. And he walks up to her, he goes, ma'am, just what seems to be the problem here? And she goes, with this real beautiful look she's giving me right now, she's scared. Don't think Rosa Parks wasn't scared. She was scared. You all know what could have happened to her, okay? And so she kind of takes a big gulp and kind of looks up at the sheriff and said, why can't we all be just left alone? And that hits the sheriff. And he sits down next to her. And he reaches his hand over. And he shakes her hand and he says, you know what? What you did here today took a lot of courage. And I really admire you for it. And it would be an honor for me and my deputy to escort you home safely. Would that be all right? And of course she nods like that, but she's still not sure what's going on here. This is an anomaly. This hasn't happened. The sheriff stand by while lynchings happen back then. She's not too sure she trusts this, but she goes along and he says, where's your stop? And she says, a couple of streets up on Elm Street. I don't know, I made that up. Whatever. So they get off together. And the good sheriff turns over to her and looks at her and he goes, hey, it's kind of late. Do you need to get some hamburgers or something for dinner for your husband and family? She goes, yeah, that'd be nice. And he goes, well, there's an all-white restaurant right there. Why don't we go in there? So he takes Mrs. Parks in there with his deputy. And, of course, people in there are going, what's the sheriff doing in here letting her buy hamburgers? You know? So they buy them. And, of course, the person sitting there at the counter looking at the sheriff for her, you know. But because the sheriff's saying to do it, get it done, they leave and they walk by an all-white water fountain. Guess what the sheriff did then? Mrs. Parks, would you like a drink? And, of course, she takes advantage and takes a nice drink. And then they go home. And they're walking up the stairs to the porch and Mr. Parks sees them. And wow, what is going on? And he comes out, what, you know, and Sheriff goes, Mr. Parks, calm down. there's a little trouble downtown on the bus. Rosa refused to give her seat to a white man.
Rosa, I told you to stop doing that crap. I told you not to do that. Sit where you're supposed to. The husband's mad at her.
He didn't want any trouble. Can you blame him? But later on, he kind of got proud of her, too. And anyway, that's not what happened at all. Do you know that Rosa Parks was taken into the police station, the sheriff's office, photographed, fingerprinted, and booked into a cell? And then later, her husband and friends bailed her out the next morning. Thank goodness. And you see, this is what I compare to Deputy Lennox. See, it's all rights. It's all people that we do this for. If there's freedom for you and not for me, or freedom for them and not for us, and all that stuff, this is never going to work. America's never going to work that way. This separate but equal doctrine just shows you once again how stupid the Supreme Court has been lots of times. They are now, they were then, and so how do we combat that? Go to court again? File another lawsuit? Enforce, defend, and obey the United States Constitution. Keep your oath, and remember that we hold these truths to be self-evident. That all men are created equal.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen. See, and maybe that's why I get a little bit choked up about stuff like that, because I always had a dream, it was on my bucket list, to shake Rosa Parks' hand someday, and I never got to. She died 10 years ago. Our own Congress gave her the highest award that you can give a civilian in this country. The highest award. For violating their stupid laws!
Yeah.
Yeah. That's astonishing. But they did. And you know what? She is an American hero. And you know what? We should have never heard of Rosa Parks. We should have heard of the cops that stopped that day.
Yes.
But no, Rosa was left alone. She had to fight the entire system. Of course, they did a boycott on the buses and a lot of other things. But it started turning things around, and we need to do the same now. A peaceful stand against those who would arrest us for mere possession of a gun, those who would arrest us for being in an airport passing out flyers, those who would arrest us like at the Bundy Ranch. They said, this is the federal government. This is so Rosa Parks situation, it's not even funny. You can have freedom of speech. You have the right to peaceably assemble. As long as you do it over there in that corral where we made those fences, see those 20 fences that we put there? See that nice little, I mean, you can do cage fighting in there, and you can do all sorts of things in there. But if you do freedom of speech outside that corral, or if you try to peaceably assemble outside that corral, then you'll go to jail. That's your federal government at the Bundy Ranch saying that. Have they done it other places? How about, did you see New York where they were doing it with the occupied teenagers, whatever, and those girls screaming and screaming because they're getting maced? They get the dragnet, and the cops get the dragnet, and they put all these kids in it and protesters in it. And then they started, after they corralled them in, they just started macing them. It looked deadly the way they were macing them. And guess what each one of those persons got? $66,000 each in a lawsuit against New York. Well, I don't know how New York affords it. Eric Garner's family got $6.5 million. And it just keeps going and going. If we enforced, if we had police officers in this country that were trained in the Constitution, trained in their oath of office, trained in public relations, trained in true service, Rosa Parks today wouldn't be going to jail anymore. Rosa Parks would not be getting maced anymore. Rosa Parks wouldn't be getting beat and dragged and kicked like the 10 officers to that guy in San Bernardino County after he stole the horse. He lays out prone on the desert sand because he knows what's coming. He knows he's getting a beating. And he couldn't have been more docile if he had to. Completely face down in the dirt, not armed, not doing anything. And what do 10 deputies do? Do a tag team on him, kicking him in the head. I thought he was killed. shown on national television. He got $650,000.
That was in my hometown.
Astonishing. Astonishing. I can't believe that we do that. And yet, in the corner is my briefcase on that chair. Could you bring it to me?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. And
you were at the Bundy Ranch.
I was at the Bundy Ranch. And as a matter of fact, I took my youngest son with me. We're driving up there in our truck, and I'm just going from Phoenix to Vegas. And this is an hour, so it's about a six-hour drive. And everything is going, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Everything's going to pot on my way there. Mm-hmm. This is when the protesters are all going to get the cows out. I told everybody there, we had CSPOA members there, we had Oath Keepers there. I said, wait till we get there, don't do anything. Don't do anything until we get there. Probably a good thing they did, because I was in no mood. And, yeah, I gotta show you this. Okay. So, how do we trust anybody from the federal government? I mean, you could go look, I mean, you could take the last 3 years, 2 years, 10 years, 20 years, and just ask yourself, how do we trust the federal government? Both parties in Washington, D.C. have promoted, not just allowed, promoted the abuse and crimes by the IRS. Both parties. Don't tell me it hasn't been both parties. It's been both parties.
Yeah.
Both parties, no matter who's president, shut off the water in Klamath Falls, Oregon, and in the Napa Valley in California right now. Is it Napa Valley or is it some other valley?
San Joaquin.
San Joaquin Valley. Yes, thank you. Where we get 50% of our fruits, vegetables, and nuts for the whole country. They turn off the water. You know why they have a water shortage? Oh, it's because of the drought. No, it's because of stupid people that turn off the dams. That's why. I went there myself. I was in Merced, California, campaigning in Merced County for a sheriff there, a sheriff candidate. He won. And I saw the farms, and he showed me around when he picked me up from the airport. He showed me. And the signs were there. This is my farm since the federal government turned it off. Dust and weeds. That's all it was. Where we used to get our food in this country. Who's talking about that? Nobody. Okay. Oh, yeah. That's just what the government does. They shut them off. Bush administration did Klamath Falls. Obama administration did San Joaquin Valley. Why are they trying to destroy our food supply? Did they try to destroy our food supply at the Bundys?
Yeah.
Yep.
There were 53 ranchers in Clark County, Nevada. Guess how many there are today?
He's about it, right?
One.
One.
Just the Bundys. Yep. The only one that has survived is the one who refused to pay the government or go along and sign any of their contracts anymore. Guess what? All the 52 that are out of business now, we're all paying their fees. Yep. They're all paying their fees. So which one is getting slammed? The one who refused. Oh, he's a crook, he's a criminal, he's crazy. He's a domestic terrorist. Then I say, make me one too then. And so Reed called me one too. Harry Reid called me one too. And I was gonna do something to get arrested for. I admit it. And my kids kept calling me on my way there. I guess my wife told him, you better call Dad, I think he's up to something. And so all my kids, I have five kids, I only took one with me. So my other four kids are, Dad, why are you going up there? And I told them why. I said, because I'm not going to watch a Ruby Ridge and a Waco happen again. I watched the other two and I'm not watching this time. They said, okay, well, don't do anything stupid, okay? I said, boy, do they know me or what? Yeah. So I said, I'm not going to do anything stupid. I'm just going to take a sledgehammer to those free speech zones that the government established. That's all I'm gonna do. Mm-hmm. I'm tearing those down. They wanna take me in, so be it. But why do we put up with these folks? Tell me if anybody went to jail for this or if anybody was even prosecuted for this. Front page, USA Today, okay? Every time I buy a USA Today, it's because I see some other abuse from the federal government on the front page. This is it, US drug agents engaged in sex parties. Well, at least when the Secret Service does it, they pay for their own. Okay? But the DEA, for years, Drug Enforcement Administration agents posted in Colombia engaged in sex parties. For years. And guess who provided the prostitutes? The cartels. The very cartels they're fighting, supposedly. So, do you think that even in Colombia that it would be against the law to do that? Yeah. So the Republicans call the people in, you know, the head of the DEA, and ream them out, point their finger at them, and guess how many got prosecuted? Zero. Guess how many were fired? Zero. Guess how many were disciplined? Zero. Oh, and so then after the Republicans really went after them, then the new female head of the DEA resigned. That's justice for you, isn't it? Just, yeah. And of course, this the date of this was March 27th of this year, just a few months ago. We had the most transparent and honest administration in history. Fast and furious, and Tea Party's being attacked by the IRS, and any other. I will tell you this, I was ahead of the curve, because when we formed the CSPOA is when the IRS actually started the abuse on constitutional groups, and our first word is constitutional sheriffs, constitutional. So I never asked the IRS permission to exist. We just started it as a business. I got a local business license in Texas when I was there, and that was it. We're not 501c3. Don't want to be. Don't want to ask permission. Don't want to work with them. Don't want their permission. Don't want them to be in my life. If they come audit us, what example am I going to follow? Well, of course. Was it Lois Lerner, mm-hmm. who was the head of the IRS, and then she got her big full $200,000 a year retirement? She said this, I haven't done anything wrong, I haven't broken any laws, and I plead the Fifth Amendment. They come to talk to me, that's all I'm saying. I said, you remember her? And I quote, okay? You want something else from me? I'll say the same thing. Plead the Fifth. Goodbye. See you later. I'll go to Sheriff Arpaio's office and sit there and tell him to protect me when he's not too busy in court. So, the other one. Yes, I have another little goodie in here to show you. Okay, here it is. Okay. Time Magazine. Boy, this is my second reference to Time Magazine. This is October 23rd, 1995. I just filed my lawsuit a year before then, and this man in the front was a very dear friend of mine. He was doing something crazy in Nye County, Nevada, standing against the Forest Service and the BLM there. They had a road washout. And he's a county commissioner for Nye County, Nevada. It's just an hour from Las Vegas, just over the mountain, and due west. And the three county commissioners there voted unanimously to just go fix the road, as long as Dick Carver was the one on the bulldozer fixing it. Well, he was a machine operator, so he said, yeah, I want to. So they went out there one brisk morning, and about three or four federal agents are there, and about 150 people, the militia. Yeah, just people. The people. I asked, sir, what is the militia? It is the whole body of the people, said George Mason, said Richard Henry Lee, said Thomas Jefferson, and so on. It's us. So the militia was there, sheriff wasn't, a couple of deputies were, and a bulldozer with Dick Carver. The federal agents, as soon as he started to try to fix the road, they stand and said, stop in the name of the law, get out from there or you're going to go to jail. He got off, went over to the deputies and to the militia and said, if they get in the way again, arrest them, and if you don't arrest them, I'm going to run over them. He got back up on his bulldozer, started off, they got out of the way, and he fixed the road. Took him a couple hours. Okay, big deal. Time Magazine puts it on the front page of their issue in 1995. And they were, because federal agents were so afraid that things would turn violent if they allow this sagebrush rebellion to continue. Yeah, I know. My dear friends, it's time that this sagebrush rebellion go bigger, better, and faster. Badge versus the badge. I cannot take credit for that title because it comes from Range Magazine in an article of 2003. I think it was the winter issue, if you want to look it up on the internet. Range Magazine has an article, Badge versus the Badge. Why did they? Because some crazy sheriffs, one Gary Amon in Owee County, Idaho, told the BLM to get out of his county, leave people alone, the cattle were staying. They've tried this Bundy stuff before, and they've tried it since Bundy. They're doing one right now in Arizona. They're doing another one in South Dakota against some Lakota Sioux there. They don't care. They don't care what race. They don't care who you are. They're going to just take the cattle because why? They can. And the sheriffs have got to stop this. It's ridiculous that we sit back and watch people lose their farms and ranches and the government just says, well, because we're in charge, that's why. And what are they paying people off? Gary Amon told the federal government, get lost. Sheriff from San Bernardino County, Sheriff Penrod, tells the federal government to get lost. My God, if they can do it in San Bernardino, California, we can do it here in Mississippi, for heaven's sakes. My goodness. He tells it, in fact, look what he said. Revoke law enforcement authority from all federal government across all 20,000 miles of his, square miles of his county. One of the biggest counties in the country, by the way. Okay. And Sheriff Ken Jones from Eureka County, Nevada, did the same thing. Look what he said. What they really want is to extend federal authority over all law enforcement in the United States, whether local people agree with them or not. Well, it's not in my county. It's not in this county. It's all we want sheriffs to say. You're not going to do that in my county anymore. But they need your backing. And they need this education. And what we want now is many of you to come to our certification training, and we'll give you an announcement. I'll make sure you know. But we'll give you an announcement. We're hoping to do this within 2 months. Might even be in December, first part, so we stay away from Christmas. Or right after, maybe in January, but right after. And we're going to do a national certification to make you a CSPOA instructor, that you give this class that I'm giving now in your area. I can't be everywhere. There's not enough of us doing it. We need you to do it. You come to a 2-day seminar, get certified, and then you get back here to your state, and you start providing this training. Let's start bam, bam, bam. Go to every sheriff's office, go to chiefs of police, go to county commissioners, and show them this training, and let's get these people to be Stan Lennox right now. Let's get people to be Sheriff Brad Rogers and Sheriff McGee's right now. We don't have time to wait, and we need you. So it has to go. Yeah.
What do you do about the sheriffs that are complicit with the federal government?
Ignore them. Start off with the others. But I honestly feel this. Even some of those guys are good people. They're just wrong. You put the right information in front of the right people, they'll do the right thing. But there's some others who you're never going to get. So remember, there's 3,100 sheriffs. To really make this happen, we need about a fourth of them. So we don't even need 1,000. We need maybe 600-700. So let's get that 600-700. Because if we get that 600-700, there's going to be no stopping it. Okay? And then everybody in this country has at least 2 or 3 places in each state where they can go for refuge. A true constitutional sheriff that will tell the federal government, you're not going to abuse citizens here anymore. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. I love that badge versus the badge. And really, this is part of your question, too. When we have lived under pernicious power long enough, no matter how oppressive, we grow so accustomed to the yoke that its removal seems frightening, even wrong. That's really what this is. You go tell the sheriff, yeah, you do this, you know, do this. You, oh, well, I'll lose funding, or, you know, no, that's not how we do it, you know, or that's not the way it's done. Yeah, we admit that. The criminal aspect and the criminal behavior that's gone on and has been accepted for oh so long in this country, and that we continue to allow this to occur in our counties and our states and our country, is absolutely ridiculous. And then these people are held up as heroes when they retire, if they ever do. Thank goodness the president's only 8 years, and we can get rid of those crooks. But for these others, like the John McCains and Orrin Hatches and the others that just stay there forever, like we just have to have them. You know what? Normal people want to retire. They want to. Oh, so that, what does that say about John McCain?
Not normal.
Cannot be normal. No way. So, yeah. I mean, there's a, every state has had them. Every state has them. I don't care what party they are. The founding fathers never intended for career politicians to be in there and just be implanted until they die or they finally feel like leaving. Ridiculous. We've got to take America back, and we can. And I, again, I want to highly recommend this book to each of you. I also have the sign-up forms. Become a member. Join the holy cause of liberty. This is all about what we're doing. And Justice Scalia, I'll end with his most powerful statement in this book. And I absolutely, this whole thing will just enthrall you. Right here on page 13. But the Constitution protects us from our own best intentions. Did you hear that? But the Constitution protects us from our own best intentions. It divides power among sovereigns and among branches of government precisely so that we may resist the temptation to concentrate power in one location as an expedient solution to the crisis of the day. The crisis of the day?
Yeah,
anybody ever hear of that?
Yeah.
It was the Obama administration motto.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, Rahm Emanuel said it all the time. Never let a good crisis go to waste. And that's what they've done. In fact, we got Obamacare because of it.
I think they've created the crisis.
Yeah, exactly. And they created it. There was no health care crisis in America. Not until federal government created it. And let me tell you, I have personally seen how horrible it is now. And I can't even, I work almost full time now just to pay our health insurance. Literally. I can't, the Affordable Care Act, I can't even afford the premiums at all. But I have co-pays and deductibles. And they're literally sending us broke. Literally. My wife's going in for surgery Tuesday.
And, she had a stroke, didn't she?
Huh?
Did she have a stroke?
No, she had MRSA. And now she's got arthritis so bad that she has to have both knees replaced. Oh. So that's what she's doing. So she can't even hardly walk around. I tell you, it's just a, for her just to walk into church, it's just such a drudgery. Yeah.
I got a quick, when you were talking earlier about it's the duty to of that officer to protect the constitutional rights of people or to protect
whoever it is
in general.
Yeah.
What do you think about the ruling Warren versus District of Columbia?
Remind me which one that was.
Okay. The headline here in the New York Times says, "Justices ruled," and this is in 2005, "police do not have the constitutional duty to protect someone."
I thought that was Williams. It was Warren?
Warren.
It was a black lady getting raped.
Right.
Yeah, and I thought it was Williams.
Well,
yeah,
she put a protective order against an estranged husband.
Right. She calls in, and she gets attacked while she's on the phone, and the cops never come.
That's right.
Yeah.
But their ruling said that not only do they not have an obligation to protect her
right.
with a restraining order,
right.
they have no obligation to protect anyone.
Right. Totally.
So how do you argue with that?
Yeah, it's really difficult, but morally, and is their job to get there? Then the court is saying, though, if they don't make it in time, and even if they don't do their job right, you still can't sue them for it. So are the sheriffs and chiefs still going to be telling their cops to get there? Of course. But this was a very poor supervised department. The dispatch was very poorly supervised. And just happened to be a stupid time when everything just went stupid. So she sued him, and she lost. So again, the courts don't run our police departments. And at first, they should have fired a bunch of people in that office and made sure people got in there that knew what they were doing. But this is the whole thing with all of law enforcement nationwide, my dear friends. How many times have you heard, besides Sheriff Clark and me, say that we've got to revamp training in this country for law enforcement? None of them say that. New York, when they lost all these cases, Baltimore with all their problems there, Ferguson, everybody, I don't care where. San Francisco with the lady that gets killed from the six-time felon, illegal alien. Same thing. Nobody is talking about training. And the training is the problem. In fact, this is the mentality that we've allowed to occur in our police agencies. Okay? It's this. Well, yeah, I guess I might be a little bit too quick on the trigger sometimes, but overall, I'd rather be tried by 12 than carried by 6. That's the mentality that we're combating. And I'm going to tell every one of the cops that have been trained to believe that right now. There's a lot worse things than not going home at night. And that's shooting a 12-year-old boy with a toy gun in his hand. You think you can live with that? I can't and would never. So we need to revamp all of that and do this training completely over and still make sure people in law enforcement realize that 90% of the people they come in contact with are good law-abiding citizens. And yes, do they need to be ready and capable for the 10? Sure, that's what it's all about. But we asked for this job. And we knew it was difficult. And we knew we were doing life and death situations. That does not give us license to shoot people who are unarmed. In fact, somebody who even was armed would not deserve to be shot in most of the cases where all these occurred. And here again, Eric Garner getting choked out and killed over what? Selling cigarettes. Selling hot cigarettes. Come on.
Really?
God. That's the same thing with the drug war. The drug war has been a huge amount of abuse, has been used to foment a complete destruction of our Constitution, and has provided no benefit to our country, no benefit to our citizens. If the federal government wanted to stop drugs, tell them to do it at the border. But
they
don't.
Do is quit bringing them in.
They won't. Why? There's two groups that don't want to legalize drugs. Two. Government and the cartels.
Big pharma.
Yep. Big pharma, yeah. Okay. Yeah, true. That's the other drug dealers in the country. Okay. And doctors are some of the biggest drug dealers in the country. Oh my gosh. So none of it fits. None of it works. We've got to establish freedom in our own counties. We take America back, my friends. County by county, sheriff by sheriff, and state by state. And if you're not involved in the process, we're not going to win. Can't happen. We won't win. It will be impossible. And I'll close with this. Whoever was quoting Cleon Skousen earlier, last name Skousen, he wrote the 5,000-year leap, The Making of America, and he converted me to the Constitution in 1983 at a law enforcement seminar entitled The Constitution for Law Enforcement Officers. I learned the Constitution. I was converted. And at that seminar, I said, I will never be on the wrong side again. I will not arrest Rosa Parks, not back in 1955, and not today. And he looked me in the eye when he handed me his book, The Making of America, which I suggest all of you read. He said, promise me that you'll teach these things to your children. This is back in 1983. I kept that promise. And I started teaching these things to my grandchildren. And the oldest grandchild I have is a girl. She was born 9 years ago and a couple of months. Her name is Liberty because she was born on the 4th of July. And my precious little Libby has learned this. I went to her school and taught it to her second grade class. And I'm going to teach it all to you right now. And I'm going to leave it with you as my final words. Dr. Skousen had 240 of us big tough cops get up, and he taught us this. And it's a preamble to sign language. It goes just like this. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. And that's the eagle. Long may she be free.